My name's Nigel. This is my colleague Stefan.
Hello.
We've been working over the past year and a half or so to build a new set of official drivers for Neo4j. And so we're going to give you a bit of an overview of the functionality for those right now. So if this works, look, it's broken. Look at that. Good start.
Okay.
Right. So what are we building? Well, we're building some officially supported drivers that give a new set of API for accessing Neo4j that is intended to be uniform across the board. So regardless of what programming language you're working with, we ultimately want your experience to be the same. So far, there's been a lot of community drivers that have been built, and there's been some variation in how you access Neo4j because of that. And so we're just trying to tidy up that effort, take responsibility for some of it, and move forward with that. So yes, we've seen some inconsistent patterns of usage across the drivers in the past. And different feature sets that are available depending on what language you're in. You may have a better time than other languages. Java has often been seen in this case as a bit of a first-class citizen, so if you're not a Java developer, you may feel a bit hard done by at times. There have been lots of type systems that you've typically had to deal with. So the Java type system itself, Cypher has a certain set of types that you have to deal with. And then if you're using the HTTP interface, you'll often have to deal with JSON and the fun that comes with that. JSON itself is quite poor at times at representing complex data, so we wanted to move past that and come up with something a bit more dedicated to the type of data we were working with. And finally, HTTP itself can be a bit limiting. It can be a bit verbose. You're going to ship HTTP headers with each request and response that you're throwing over the network. And we can do away with some of that and reduce the payload overall. So this illustrates with a few very British telephone references, basically what we've been trying to build. So the protocol itself is implemented by connectors on either side of the communication. One connector sits in the driver itself, which acts on behalf of the application. And the other connector sits in the Neo server. And they exchange cipher messages going to the server and the results, which are streams of records, coming back again. The client connectors that we're building implement a standardized API that we've defined so that we know, regardless of which language you're going to be using, you have a very similar experience, a very similar set of classes and methods that you're working with. And drilling down a little bit into how the data flow itself works, the driver sends a string of a Cypher statement plus a set of parameters, as is the current experience with using Cypher, but this is the only interaction you actually have over Bolt. All you can do is Cypher. All of the other things that you can currently do on the HTTP interface, we've turned into stored procedures, and you'll hear more about those a bit later on. And then coming out of the server, a stream of records, which you can read one at a time as you need them, back into the driver. So you don't have to, in the same way that you would with JSON, collect them all up and return one big object. You have a streaming capability here. And as well as the results themselves, some metadata coming back from the server to describe maybe the plan of the query that you've run, the field names of the data that you pulled back, and so on.
So how is all this exposed, right? Of course, it's nice to develop a protocol, but you don't want to send just binary over the wire in your application. You need a nice API. And when we started out this, I don't know if how many people in here have ever done cross-language API design, but that turns out to be really hard, right? So what is the problem, really, right? Because you have these two kind of competing things. On the one hand, you want things to be really, really uniform. For various reasons, actually. One reason is it's really nice if you talk to your colleague in that other team that happens to use another language if you understand each other, right? If you talk about the same concept, right? And there is no mismatch there. Perhaps even more importantly and a bit more subtle is having uniform drivers guarantees that you have the exact set of functionality across all the different platforms, right? Which is not so easy to achieve in other cases, right? If you even look at today's community drivers, I'm sure it's not too difficult to find slight variations in what they expose of Neo4j as it stands before 3.0, right? So that's one side of things. Then again, if you put everything in a straitjacket, you end up with a different problem, right? Because then out of a sudden, your driver feels like, I don't want to use this. This feels like Java, and I write Scala. Or this feels like Python, and I hate it because I'm a Ruby coder, or whatever it is, right? So you also have that. And you need to kind of balance these things out against each other to have a really awesome usage experience. So how did we approach this, right? So the third goal, perhaps, here is you have to address that tension, and you want to address it in a way that the result is still simple, right? You can't solve this problem by making it complex. So our approach to this is to provide each driver package will give you four key abstractions, right, which I'd like to talk through now, right? The first one is, of course, the driver itself, which is essentially a template for creating sessions. Right? So a driver encapsulates your interaction with a given instance of Neo4j. So it will hold your usage credentials. It may have configuration things for the size of your session pool. It will have the URL to your bold server, all these things. That's what a driver is. And you create this once for your application, right? And then you use it across your stack. Right? So once you have a driver, you can ask it to give you a session. Right? And the way we've dubbed it here on the slides is a session is a logical context for database interaction. So that is essentially like giving you this illusion, I'm working with a database all by my own, and I'm sending Cypher, and I'm executing queries, and I'm getting results back. Right? That is what a session is. And they get mapped internally, of course, onto a pool of connections that actually executes the binary bold protocol. Right? So, but you don't have to deal with that side of things. You just work with a session, which is a logical entity for interacting with the database. Right? So then, last not least, of course, Neo4j is not just some key value store. Of course, it gives you full asset transactions, so we had to expose that as well. So a session is also a means of creating transactions if you need to send multiple Cypher statements as one logical unit of work, like you used to if you've used Neo4j in the past. Right? So you can also do that. Nevertheless, in any case, whether you're sending one-off queries or whether you're executing multiple queries in the transaction, right? At the end of the day, you need your results back, and that's called a statement result. So the model here, as Nigel has already outlined, essentially, whenever you send a statement over the wire, you get kind of like a handle back, which gives you, you can then continuously pull, and you get essentially a stream of records returned from the database, right? What this model allows you is to do pipelining. So you can send multiple queries in one go and then consume the results in order without having to wait for a whole latency cycle, right? So these things are possible. So let's look a little bit how it looks like. I won't show the code now for all the different drivers, but let's spend some time with the Java driver and then have a brief look at all the other drivers, right, that we're shipping as part of the 3.0.ga release. So first of all, you have to set up a driver, which you see in the first line here. So you create a driver by saying graph-database.driver, and then you have to provide it with a bold URL, which describes essentially your connection endpoint. And so you say bold :// localhost, so we've really registered a new protocol for this, right? And then you provide credentials, et cetera, right? So once you've created a driver, you use it to obtain a session, right? That's as simple as saying driver.session, right? And then you do session run to execute your cipher, right? And that's basically the main interaction flow, right? When running a session here, you could also pass on statement parameters like you used to today, via the REST API. And then you get back a statement result. And in the simple example here, all we do is we iterate over the result to essentially print the records. And we're always printing two fields, title and name, right? Perhaps worth pointing out here that you have to do a little bit of work here to kind of tell the driver as you're accessing the record how you want the result that has been returned to be converted into a Java type. And that is a bit that will vary a bit between the different drivers depending on the language being used, right? For example, you don't do that in Python where you work directly with native values, right? But in Java, it makes sense to be more explicit here, for example. So let's look at another driver, the Python driver, right? Yeah, cute's a charm, right? Python, everybody who knows it loves it because of that, right? It's essentially, again, the same pattern, just shorter, right? So you create your driver. You set up a session.
Well, gloss over the fact that we've actually missed a line out there.
Yeah, that's essentially.
You create a session. Trust
that's
us.
That's testament to how fresh these slides are. So, and then you run your query, right? And you proceed the result. You process the results by looping over them, right? Nothing special here, right? Again, the .NET driver follows a similar pattern, Right, it's essentially it's a bit different because .NET does this driver's resources thing here using the using keyword, right? But it is again the same pattern. Get a driver, create a session, run a query, consume the results. That's all, right? Last not least, the JavaScript driver also allows you to do the same pattern, but because JavaScript is inherently the way it's used in web browsers and Node.js and modern platforms, it's inherently asynchronous, it also gives you an asynchronous API for consuming result records, so you don't end up in a blocking situation with your JavaScript code, right? So
these official drivers, a bit about the projects themselves. So each of the drivers, each of the four drivers are hosted on GitHub, and this means that any issues with them, you can raise there. We're going to be actively monitoring those issue lists. Also, any PRs, if you see a bug or something you want to fix and feel the urge to do so, please post on GitHub your pull request. All of them are Apache licensed, and that's slightly different to the licensing that we've chosen for the Neo server itself, which is GPL. The Apache licensing gives us a bit more commercial friendliness and means that the drivers aren't going to hit any issues with commercial applications. The drivers are versioned and released independently of Neo4j itself. While we're generally going to keep them in step with each other, and we'll probably patch them separately out of necessity, don't expect the version numbers to match up between the driver and the server, largely because going forward, one driver is going to be able to support multiple versions of the server. And we're publishing each of the driver bundles to the place you'd expect to go from your ecosystem. So for Java, to Maven, for Python to PyPy, and so on. And so, very briefly, here's how you'd install in your given language. In Java, you'd inject a dependency. In XML, then Python, you do a pip install, JavaScript and npm install, and if you happen to be using .NET, I hear some people do, then you'll do a package install. And there's an expert over the back there that I'll point you to later if you happen to be a Windows user. So the community drivers. These have existed for quite some time, and what we didn't want to do with this project was to come and stamp all over the efforts of the community driver authors. I myself was one for quite some time before joining Neo. But we think what we've built are a set of drivers that can complement the community driver as well. We want to provide something that gives you a fundamental foundation that provides the plumbing that speaks bold. But the community drivers can add extra value by adding higher level API. They can add more language idiomatic features to the drivers as well. Several community drivers are already pretty much complete. There's a PHP and a C driver that have got, well, they're very mature at this stage. And there are a few that are less mature that are being worked on. But if you are a budding driver author, then we have some good resources for you. So there's an Neo4j ecosystem mailing list that you can sign up to, and we have a more public Slack channel that you can join and come and chat to us. There's a protocol channel on there. But also, you can get in touch with us, drivers@neo4j.com, and we'll try and help you out if you're building us a driver. So a quick overview of what the two protocols look like side by side. The traditional HTTP over there, and both of these were done very, very quickly. They won't illustrate necessarily your use case, but they show a typical setup. So your request and response will typically contain a load of HTTP headers and a JSON payload. And if you contrast that with the binary that's sent to and fro with Bolt, you're getting some significantly smaller requests and responses, so naturally you're going to get a bit of better performance overall. The payload for Bolt itself uses a data serialization mechanism that we've built in-house that is very closely tied to the Neo4j type system, which we've done a lot of work on to standardize across the board. And I suppose the other thing to compare is that as you're using a session in Bolt world, you have a stateful setup rather than the stateless setup that you'd have with HTTP. So you don't need to send auth information and so on for every request. So back to Stefan.
Alrighty. So that's all awesome, right? I think we will see a lot of amazing applications done with the new drivers, right? But of course, if you've been around a little longer, you know that if you want to get the maximum out of Neo4j, you need to implement maybe specialized algorithms or talk to some third-party system. And the way to go is to use an extension that directly plugs into the database and executes directly on the bare metal, right? So of course, when we came up with the Bolt protocol and the whole drivers project, it was immediately obvious that we need to preserve that capability, right? And of course, we just don't want to preserve it. We want to give you something better, right? And that's what Java stored procedures are, right? So Java stored procedures allow you with a really, really simple way to write a bit of custom code, plug that into the database, deploy it really simple, and then essentially run it via Cypher. Right, and just access it via Bolt with all the benefits of the new protocol, which is usually much faster than HTTP, right? And the nice usability benefits we just saw, right? So just briefly, right, the product already comes with a couple of built-in procedures. Of course, we're also testing the waters here ourselves, right? So what you used to do, you know, via the REST API or maybe on the shell, right, if you wanted to access the schema, right, there were like special ways to do that, right, all this has been now or is slowly moving over to built-in procedures. So there are procedures for getting the list of all labels, property keys, relationship types, right, these things. You can get the indexes, you can get the constraints, right, these are exposed as procedures. And then there are also, these are kind of more data centric, right, and then there are more system-centric procedures for listing the procedures itself, getting information about the database itself, right, querying the monitoring system, changing your password, and I'm sure we're going to see way more interesting procedures going forward. So let's jump into the thick of it, right? How do you write one, right? And the idea here is essentially you have to write 1.5 classes, 1.5, saying 1.5 because the second class almost doesn't count because it is so simple, right? So let's look at the first one. The first class here called your procedure class is the class that actually holds your logic, your application logic, right? And what you do is you essentially write a custom method, right, that takes arguments like any method in Java would, right? And you have to annotate it a bit. So you have to say, this is a procedure, right? You could give some description string, which then might show up in documentation, right? You have to name the arguments explicitly, right? And that's all you need to know, right? And then you can start coding, right? And then, of course, the second question is, how do you return data from it, right? And you do that by returning a stream of something, right? And that's where we come to the half class that I haven't explained, and that's basically just a simple container class which has some fields, right, that you have to declare depending on your needs, essentially, right? So here we have, in this prototypical example, we'll look at a real example in a bit, right, in this demo thing here, we return records that only have a single field called value of some type, right? And so if the procedure gets called, it will return a stream of these records, right? So then, last not least, that would be almost complete, but of course the question is, from within a procedure, how do I actually access the database? And that's done with a, you know, standard injection type of mechanism for those of you who know Java. So you have to kind of in your class say, okay, I would like to use a graph database service, I would like to use a logging facility, whatever it is, and then you annotate that, and then you get that injected at runtime so that your procedure logic can access these things, right? To work with the graph. Let's maybe look at a little bit more concrete example, right? Who here knows the SIP function in Cypher? Just a little test. Oh, that's okay. So let's explain that first then. So the SIP function in Cypher is a tiny little utility. What it does is you give it two lists, right? And it gives you back a list of pairs, right? So it just takes them like a zipper, right? Essentially, that's what it does, right? So Cypher had that built in, but occasionally it's convenient to actually not get that back as a list, but as a sequence of rows in the query, right? That sometimes is practical. So here we have a little function that I've actually copied from Michael Hunger's APOC procedure repository that does essentially that, right? So we have a procedure, right? It has a description, say it zips two lists, but it emits one row per pair, right? And it has two arguments, list one and list two, and it returns a list result, right? And then if we look below, we see a list result is just, you know, a list of things, basically, right? So it's, oh, actually, yeah, no, that's correct. It's a list of things, right? So and then yeah, the implementation is kind of trivial. If the first list is empty, we return nothing because then there's nothing to zip, right? And otherwise, it's essentially like a nested loop. So you go over the outer list and then combine it with the elements from the inner list, right? So maybe not the most graphic example here, but I wanted to have something that fits on a single slide, and it gets a bit more tricky with the more complex examples, right? So how do you call it, right? Because that's, of course, interesting, right? So for that, we made a new addition to Cypher, right? You can call it in two different ways. You can call it standalone, which we like to, yeah, the standalone call form, which is just, you say, run call.zip, and now the slide has this horrible bug. This should be session.run for those of you who have paid attention, right? So just ignore that it's session.run here in the first line. And then, yeah, you just say call zip, and then you can pass the parameters. By the way, this is a nice example of how parameters are passed in the Java driver, right? Just like that. And then that's nice, but let's say you have a more complex example, right? Let's say you want to use a procedure from Cypher, right? And then combine it with other features of Cypher. And let's look at that, right? And that's called call and yield. So if we look here at the second example, we search for all knights in our database, right? If you look at the new Neo4j driver manual, you notice that we have switched the examples a bit to King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table, right? So very nice to talk about this today in this location, I think. So you go from all the knights and you find all the knights that lives in Camelot, right? And then we find the distinct ones because we might get duplicates at this point, right? And then let's say we also have a list of names of squires, right? And we want to kind of pair up the knights, each knight with a squire here, right? And so we call zip with the knights, and then here the squires, I wanted to keep the example short, are passed as a parameter, right? And then we just yield back the pair that has been constructed by the zip function as a result and return all that, right? And of course, way more interesting things are possible with that. That's just a simple example to kind of show off a bit the syntax, right? How you use it, but you now can freely combine your custom code for accessing third-party systems, for doing custom application logic, for doing interesting recommendation algorithms within the database, whatever it is that you do, right? You can combine it with all the power and ease of use of Cypher. And I think that's really nice, right? And we haven't had that before. So yeah, Emil already mentioned it during the keynote, right? Michael Hunger was so excited about all that, for those of you who know him, right? That he created immediately this APOC procedures repository. And I really invite all of you, if you're interested in the more programming side of using our product, right, just go there, have a look at the code, and enjoy all the little things he's done, right? And last but least, because I was very busy with other things last week, I missed that one that made me really happy to see yesterday, right? So one thing he did that also was demoed by Emil earlier is, right, it is such a simple thing to do with the procedure, right? To just say, okay, let's plug into one of these legacy relational stores, right, and pull the data out and put it into a graph, right? And you can do that with a, I don't know, it's probably a 10 or 20 line procedure or something like that, right? And now you can pull all your data into the graph, right? And with Neo4j 3.0, you definitely also have the capacity with a new big enterprise store to do that, right? And then, yeah, just use it, right? Here's just an example how you would just return it. But of course, you know, you can take this procedure, just replace the return with a create statement, and then you start getting data into your graph store and use it from there, right? Yeah, I was so happy about it that I had to add the all hail the graph, because now we're pulling data in, right, at that fast rate. So let's summarize a little bit. Drivers give a uniform new cross-language surface API to access your graph. I think that's kind of the outside perspective on it, right? Under the hood, of course, Neo4j 3.0 gives you this really awesome next generation binary protocol which will help you with throughput, which will help you with performance, and has a lot of good things to it, right? And then to mesh that up with unmanaged extensions in the past, right, we also give you procedures for executing your custom application logic in the database via Cypher without having any impedance mismatch of sorts or anything like that, right? And it all comes with a shiny new developer manual, which includes code examples for the drivers for all the different languages, so you just can find what do I want to do in a driver, okay, how does it look in .NET, how does it look in Java, how does it look in C#, right? and we're sure going to expand on that going forward, I think. And start contributing, right? All the drivers are out on GitHub. We had quite a few nice contributions during the development period, which was really nice, right? Which you maybe don't get as often for the main product. And yeah, I think it's awesome. Sorry.
Yes, we are. You're absolutely right. You can tell we haven't checked these before we put them up. Yeah.
All right.
There should be an extra Neo4j before the project.
All right. Yes.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And we're also missing an R from source code as well. But there's no prize for spotting these, unfortunately.
Right. Okay, let's wrap up. I think we're running a little early, actually, which is a bit surprising. Is there one more?
Not going. There's one more.
So maybe one thing, actually, we're saying all the drivers have been developed internally with a TCK. So there's a set of Cucumber files that isn't officially released yet, but if you look at the driver source code, you will see that we pull those in, right, from a remote location and run them as tests. And certainly, we don't have an ETA for that, but that's going to be published also going forward so that people can develop conforming drivers as well, from a community perspective, beyond the official drivers released as part of 3.0. Right? Okay, so let's wrap up. We are all here at GraphConnect, right? The driver team is here. Nigel is here. Jake is here. Pontus is here. I don't see Jen right now, but she's also here. Oh, right. Okay. But she's here as well.
She's definitely here.
Right. So we're here. Talk to us. Ask us questions. We'll now be outside answering questions about procedures, drivers, and Bolt, and anything Neo4j. And we should also give, I want to give a big thank you also to the contributors who have helped out during the development period of the driver project. Right. So thanks, everybody.
Thank you.